Very warm welcome to you all. I hope you are feeling warm. It's nice and warm here, a lot warmer than my house, I must say. Whether you're here at St. Peter and St. Paul this morning, or if you have joined us at home, welcome. It's a pleasure to be leading us through our service here this morning. My name is Claire Page, and I'm a member here of this church. Later on, Wendy, our associate vicar, will be continuing our sermon series on the book of Luke, following the break we had last week where we looked at the supremacy of Christ. If you missed it, you can catch up on our YouTube channel, where in fact you can catch up on any of the previous week's services if you missed them, or if you want to revisit the sermons again just to fill in any gaps or anything you think you missed. But now, let us turn our hearts and our minds to God as we open our service in prayer. Please do join me with the words in bold on the screen. Loving God, we have come to worship you. Help us to pray to you in faith, to sing your praise with gratitude, and to listen to your word with eagerness. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. They were not the words on the screen, but hopefully you still all joined with me in prayer. Now, something we can all do together. Please do stand, if you can, for our first hymn this morning, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues.
Praise, my great Redeemer's grace.
Please do take a seat. Now, as always, we have lots going on in the life across the parish. Hopefully you received the weekly email from Jane on Friday with all of the details, or you have picked up a printed piece if that's not accessible to you. If not, please do ask to be added to that email list or pick up a copy of the sheet. But I'll give you a few of the highlights just now. So first of all, whether you're a man of Kent or a Kentish man, I can never remember the difference, there is a Kent Men's Convention coming up soon on sovereignty, and it explores how God is sovereign over creation, humanity, salvation, and suffering, and what that means for our lives. If you're a man, whether from Kent or not, I don't think it matters. You are very welcome to join with other men across Kent on Saturday, the 4th of March, at St. Nick's in Sevenoaks. That's between 10 and 3:30. And all of that information, plus details on how to book, are in the newsletter. We also have the Lent course for 2023 coming up. It will be running on Tuesday evenings. It runs for 6 weeks, starting on Tuesday the 28th of February. That's here at St. Peter and St. Paul. And so there you are welcome to join us as we consider Jesus's passion together. To book your place, purely to make sure there are enough of the booklets running, please contact the parish office. Next up, we have the Burns Night Cayley coming. That's something for the adults. A great opportunity to invite friends or family, those who don't normally come to church. Maybe a good way to see that it's not just Sunday services that we run here. There'll be, it's obviously a very Scottish evening, with food, dancing, and a piper, so I have been told. It also includes a short message about the Christian faith. That is on Saturday, the 4th of February, at 7 p.m, and that is also here at St. Peter and St. Paul. That was something for the adults. We have something for the children as well. For school years 3 to 6, on Tuesday the 21st of February, 6 to 7:30 at St. Philip's, the children will be joining with the Brownies and the Beavers, who also meet that night at St. Philip's for pancake party. Bring a friend if you're of that age, or if you have neighbours of that age, or nieces, nephews, grandchildren, or so on, let them know about it as well. If you are keen to go, please let Alison know, and there are also flyers available at the back of the church for you to give away on that. Another one that John Schluter has passed me, it's a Restored Lives course that is starting on the 26th of January, that's this Thursday, in Sevenoaks, and that's for those who have gone through divorce and separation or are going through divorce and separation. That can be recent or it can be many, many years ago. It's open to everyone. There are flyers, but if you want more information, I'm sure John Schluter will be very happy to talk to you about that. Lots of information there on all of those. Like I said, please do refer to the weekly newsletter that Jane sends out on Fridays, or pick up a sheet from the back. I will hand over to Wendy for some bands.
Thank you, Claire. May I add my welcome to Claire's this morning on this beautiful, cold, but really beautiful sunny morning, isn't it? Welcome. I do have the privilege of reading some bands of marriage this morning. I publish the bands of marriage between Adam William Markwell and Anne-Marie Frances Kathleen Cole, both of the parish of St. Stephen's, Tunbridge, and this is for the first time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it. Let me pray for Adam and Anne-Marie. Father God, we ask you to bless Adam and Anne-Marie and grant them a deepening conviction of their love and commitment to each other. Fill them with joy on their wedding day and on the days that they are planning right now. And please help them to serve each other in love, faithfully, all of their lives, as you have served us in Jesus Christ. Amen. And we now have our vision slot. We've been looking at our vision since April, May last year. And as the new year started, we have been thinking about how the vision particularly fits into this year of ministry that's coming ahead of us at this time. We should all have a copy of one of these now and very lovely posters that you can't tell me you don't know what the vision for the parish is because it's right there in front of you. If you don't have one of these, do pick them up. They're at the end of the pews. They are for you to take. Now, last week, we thought about the foundation for our vision. What is it built on? It's built on God's word. And this week, if you look at how the bridge is standing, it has two pillars that hold it up. So this week, we're thinking about how our foundation is based on prayer as well. And there are many opportunities to pray here at St. Peter and St. Paul. And I'd like to invite a couple of people up this morning to tell us a bit more about the prayer meeting that they're involved with, or perhaps that they lead in the parish, and what has particularly encouraged them about that meeting recently. So, Richard, Josephine, I know I've seen you all, and Juliet, would you like to come up? I've got Richard first, is that all right? He says yes.
I thought it was ladies first, normally.
Well, we're going to buck the trend this morning. Rich is going to talk about Saturday morning prayers, when it happens, what happens, and an encouragement as well. And then Josephine and Juliet are going to share about the prayer meetings that they're involved in as well. Thank you, Richard.
Saturday morning prayer group happens every Saturday at 9 o'clock here in the coffee lounge. We meet for 1 hour. We pray for all aspects. So we pray for, obviously, for services the following day. We pray for every aspect of parish life and individuals in need of prayer. We pray for the world. We pray for our country and for the town. It's a special time. We enjoy each other's fellowship, and it's a real encouragement to think it's been going for, to my knowledge, 50 years. And we just love that chain of prayer to go on in the coming years. And if anybody would be interested, please talk to myself, to Judy. There are other members here, David and Wendy. I know John Schluter's here, and Sarah Thompson. So have a chat to one of us, and it would be lovely for you to join us, even if it's for now and again. Thank you.
Good morning. So I joined the Friday morning prayers online on Zoom, and we join at around 9:25 to start at 9:30. Ben normally opens with a verse from the Bible, and then we learn who is preaching in our churches on a Sunday morning, what the different children's groups are going to do from Sunday Club through SOS and even Refresh in the evening. We talk about prayer requests and thanks for events that have taken place and events that will take place. So we're praying for the Cayley, for example. And then because we're normally about a dozen that meet, if you're familiar with Zoom, you can break out into a little room. So when you're in that little room, that's when you actually do the praying. And you can pray out loud, but if you're not feeling particularly eloquent that morning, it doesn't matter if you don't say one of the prayers, because you are there praying, and that's the whole point of it. And that breakout room then ends, and we give each other a little wave, and we sometimes say the grace, and we sometimes don't. So what's the encouraging thing for me is that you can pray about big things, you can pray about small things, you can give thanks, and it also makes you remember that even though you're in one building this morning, there are three other services taking place at the same time, and you can feel a part of that too. It's great.
Good morning. The Monday morning prayer group. This is a group that meets at 9:30 every Monday. We used to meet in person, but since COVID, we are now on Zoom. And we pray for the young people of our parish, parishioners' family, friends, all sorts of young people, from babies upwards. Started 15 years ago when my eldest, Amy, was taking her GCSEs, and I wanted to help her, but wasn't sure what to do, so thought what better to do than to pray. So we started the group, and we prayed for Amy and many others doing exams. And we're still going, and Amy now has a baby of her own that we're praying for. We started as a group for exams, but it's grown. Every year we pray for exams, but we now pray for all sorts of things, for health issues, physical, mental health issues, starting new schools, new jobs, university, school issues, family issues, you name it. If as a young person has a prayer need, we will pray. We also pray for the youth groups here, all youth work, and our leaders. It's always an encouragement hearing answers to prayer, and particularly at Christmas, meeting some of our young people that we've prayed for from primary school and are now at university, and they come up to us and they tell us how they're doing, and it's really encouraging, and I know they are encouraged to know we still pray for them and support them. Currently, there are five of us in the group. A couple of us have been there since the very beginning. And we really enjoy our time together and love praying for all you young people. So if anyone would like to join us, you'd be very welcome. Or if you have any prayer needs for your young people, then please let me know or Sarah Thompson, and we'll be very happy to pray. Thank you.
A huge thank you, Richard, Josephine and Juliet. I'm sure you'll be around after the service so that people can come and talk to you about the prayer meetings. As you can see, our bridge just wouldn't stand up if it didn't have those two pillars, God's word and prayer. So we're really encouraged that there are people praying for the work of the parish each week. Let's start with a prayer. What a better way to start. Father God, we thank you for these meetings, for these prayer meetings that go on throughout the week. We thank you for the encouragement that they hear back when they see answers to prayer. But we thank you that they uphold each one of us in prayer, the work of the parish in prayer each week. Lord, encourage us and help us to know that we too can be a part of that praying community for this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
So you might be a long-term Christian, or you might be a new follower to the faith. You might be wondering what this is all about, but would you believe that we're all the same in God's eyes? We are his creation, and he loves us. But we are all equally susceptible to sin. The Bible reminds us of this and tells us that we need to confess what we've done wrong. But the Bible also tells us that because the Lord Jesus died for us, God the Father freely forgives us through his infinite goodness and mercy. So let us draw near now to God with sincerity, because we mean it, and with confidence, because we trust him, and pray together, joining with the bits in bold on the screen. Lord God, our Maker and our Redeemer, this is your world and we are your people. Come among us and save us. We have willfully misused your gifts of creation. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have seen the ill treatment of others and have not gone to their aid. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have condoned evil and dishonesty and failed to strive for justice. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have heard the good news of Christ, but have failed to share it with others. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. We have not loved you with all our heart, nor our neighbours as ourselves. Lord, be merciful. Forgive us our sin. And as I say, because we come with sincerity and with hope and with faith that we know that we are forgiven in the Lord's name. Amen. Now I'd like to invite up Andy for today's Together time.
Normally, I would be standing front and centre. However, I've suddenly realised in walking up, I forgot to get a microphone. So that is why I'm stood here at the lectern. So please excuse the not walking around as per usual. But that's okay, because actually you've got a lot of work to do this morning. So it's not all resting on my shoulders. Now, in Together time this term, we're going to be having a reflect and a think about what it is that Sunday Club are looking at through the term. And actually, today we're going to start by looking at what they did last week, which is also what SOS did last week. So those of you that are in Sunday Club and SOS, get your thinking caps on to try and remember what you did. But we are looking at parables. Now, I wonder if you can help me pick the right words from the following options to actually describe parables. Okay, so you're going to get at least two options. So here's the first one. So are parables stories about real events, or are they a load of made-up stories? Put your hands up if you think it's real events, hands down if you think it's stories. One, two, three. Okay, one or so hand for real events. So the answer is made-up stories. Well done. They are absolutely short, fictional stories. Okay, next choice. Do they use familiar situations to people, or do they use fantasy situations? So once again, hands up or down. Hands up if you think they use familiar situations. Hands down if you think fantasy. Ooh. Well, they do use things that are familiar to people. At least they probably would have been familiar to people back in the day. Okay, next one. Next choice. Jesus' parables were about, four choices here, the kingdom of God, himself, so Jesus, the future, or us. Now, this is going to be tricky. I'll go through them one at a time. Put your hand up if you think it's this. So who thinks they might be about the kingdom of God? Oh, okay, a lot of hands for the kingdom of God. Okay, hands up if anybody thinks parables might have been about Jesus himself. Oh, there's some more hands, okay. Hands up if you think any of Jesus' parables might have been about the future. Okay, some hands. And hands up if you think any of them might have been about us. Well, I'm pleased to say that the answer is yes, all four. Some of the parables, at least, touch on each one of these things. They're mostly about the kingdom of God and about Jesus as that king, but actually they're very much about us as well. And some of them are even about the future, but not all at the same time. You won't find it in every single one. Now, children, young people, maybe even leaders, I wonder if you can remind me which parable it was that we looked at last week. Who can remind me? Anyone? Any thoughts? Fiona? Yes. The builders, one who built a house on rock, the other who built his house on sand. Absolutely. Now, I wonder which builder you think we should be like. Can anyone remember which one? Yeah, all the way over there, go for it. Nice and loud. Even louder. The rock, the man who built his house on the rock. Absolutely, and I'm sure you would have also added, because building on the rock is like building on Jesus' teaching. Now, can anybody remember the vision slot from last week? We had two builders, one building on a Bible and the other on a sponge. Can you remember that? Yes, it's basically exactly the same thing. Ben did in his slot exactly what we were doing in Sunday Club and SOS, but I won't hold it against him. And that is what Jesus says building on the rock is like, actually building on his word, listening, obeying, because the house isn't just a house. The house is actually our lives. Now, there are a few different songs that you may know about a man who built his house upon a rock, and a man who built his house upon some sand. One of them may be going through your head now and you're thinking, please, please, please don't let us be singing that one. Well, I'm not sure which one that might be, but we are actually going to sing, and it's the song, Don't Build Your House on the Sandy Land. So if you didn't want it to be The Man Who Built His House Upon the Rock, you're saved. But it is Don't Build Your House on the Sandy Land. Now, in theory, I was supposed to learn actions for this. Truth be told, I watched the video once, and I'm going to try and remember those actions. So if you would like to join in with actions, please do. Otherwise, let's all join in this song together as a reminder of who we should and should not be like. So why don't we all stand to sing this very quickly? It's very short. I got very confused because I had no idea you'd be singing two things at once there. That was very confusing. Anyway, well done, everybody. You may have a seat for the moment. Now, in Sunday Club, not SOS, sorry, it's SOS, but in Sunday Club, we're doing a new parable this morning, and we're going to have a think about that next week. Next week, I promise I'll have a microphone on me. But why don't we pray for all of us now, because all of us, wherever we are, whether we're going to be staying here in the main body of church or going up to Sunday Club or SOS, we're going to be thinking and hearing about God's word to us, even though it might be different. So why don't we pray for ourselves and for each other now? Lord God, we thank you for everything that is contained within your word to us, the Bible. We ask that today you would help us to build our lives on the rock of Jesus' teaching so that we can stand firm through all the storms of life. Amen. Now, I know we've just sung, but we're going to sing twice more. Once will be all of us together, and then during the second song, those of us going out to SOS and Sunday Club, so that's anyone from age reception or in school year reception up to school year 9, will be heading out to have fun. Everyone else, you'll get to hear the next part of our sermon series here. But why don't we stand and sing together now?
Stay in the arms of mercy, reach to gather children. There is good news for the captive, good news for the shamed. There is good news for the one brought away. There is good news for the doubter, the one religion failed. Oh, the good Lord has come to see and save. He's our rescuer.
Please be seated. So we're continuing with our sermon series in Luke, and this morning we'll be reading from Luke chapter 4, beginning to read at verse 14, which can be found on page 1031 of the Church Bibles. I know that's no help to you at home, but you'll find your own way, I'm sure. Luke chapter 4, beginning to read at verse 14. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He taught in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. And he stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him, and he began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't that Joseph's son?" they asked. Jesus said to them, "Surely you will quote this proverb to me, 'Physician, heal yourself. Do here in your hometown what we have heard you did in Capernaum. I tell you the truth, he continued. No prophet is accepted in his hometown. I assure you that there were many widows in Israel in Elijah's time, when the sky was shut for 3.5 years, and there was severe famine throughout the land. Yet Elijah was not sent to any of them, but to a widow in Zarephath, in the region of Sidon. And there were many in Israel with leprosy in the time of Elisha the prophet, yet not one of them was cleansed, only Naaman the Syrian. All the people in the synagogue were furious when they heard this. They got up, drove him out of the town, and took him to the brow of the hill on which the town was built, in order to throw him down the cliff. But he walked right through the crowd and went on his way. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, Sally. Now, I wonder if, as a child, you ever experienced this, a longing for a particular toy or an item of clothing or a device as a birthday or Christmas present. That feeling of excitement as the anticipation builds that you might actually open that thing you wished for on the day. An excitement that is made even greater by the fact that when you're handed a wrapped gift on that day, you're so sure it's the right shape and weight as the thing that you've hoped for. And that it is indeed that one thing that's going to fulfill all your dreams and your wishes. And then you unwrap it. You unwrap it only to find it wasn't quite what you'd longed for after all. Perhaps it's a different colour to what you'd expected, a different style or design, or even the homemade version of the jumper that you'd so wanted. Remember how in that moment the dismantling of all your expectations in your head and your heart made you feel? In our passage in Luke today, in verse 15, we're told that everyone praised Jesus, praise and acknowledgement that this is the Jesus that they knew when he was growing up, speaking well of him, and a sense of amazement at his gracious words. Yet then, as Jesus unpacks or unwraps those words, we're told in verse 28, the people are furious. And they drive Jesus out of town in order to throw him down the cliff. Not merely disappointment over an anticipated gift, but rejection of the Son of God. The Son of God who comes as our fulfiller, comes to speak the truth of who he is and the impact of what that means for all people. Let me lead us in a prayer before we dig further into this passage. Father God, as we open this passage here this morning, may my words be those you want spoken. May they cast new light on your word, and may we each come to see them as a lamp to our feet and a guide to our lives. Lord Jesus, open our eyes, our hearts, and our minds to hear afresh from you this day. Amen. So there are three supposed knowns in this passage that we're going to explore this morning as we think about Jesus as our fulfiller. Three things that were known to the people who are with Jesus sitting in the synagogue and listening to his words on that Sabbath day. Three things. First, Jesus was known. Next, scripture was known. And finally, who this message for was known. All thought to be known by the people, but were they fully known and fully understood? And for each of those things, Jesus was known, scripture was known, and who this message was for was known, we're going to go on a little journey together this morning from the familiar to fulfillment. A journey from the familiar to fulfillment. So first, Jesus was known. Jesus was known, verses 14 to 16, we're told, Jesus returned to Galilee. News had spread about him. He taught in their synagogues. He went to Nazareth in Galilee. He'd come back home, back to the place that he'd been brought up, and went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was the custom. And today, when we see celebrities or footballers acknowledged for their achievements, there is often someone from their hometown that comes out of the woodwork sharing how they served them when they were 2 years old, they were this high, in a sweet shop or something, and saying, look how far they've come, the boy done good. And for the people of Nazareth, in this way, Jesus was familiar. He was known. Verse 22, they say, isn't this Joseph's son? Word of him had spread, and what he had been doing was exciting. Yet as we go on that journey from familiar to fulfillment, the answer to the question, is this Joseph's son, is he is God's son. The familiar suddenly becomes less clear. The people have been in some way blinded by familiarity. This child, known, familiar, loved, has returned and returns now to share the message that he is the fulfiller in that message. And all of a sudden, much seems to become utterly unfamiliar. Jesus has come, empowered by the Spirit and anointed for a purpose, and presents himself before them as the one to fulfill God's promises. Joseph's son, the one we've heard such good things about, the one who just read those familiar words of Scripture, the one whose teaching they have praised. Yet the words that follow take them into new territory, a territory of Jesus' ministry that their eyes are to be opened to, and it's not what they wanted to see. Jesus known, Jesus the son of Joseph, or the Son of God. He speaks the words of Scripture, which would have been known, those words of Isaiah the prophet. So second point, Scripture was known. Familiar and comforting words to the poor, to the prisoners, to the blind and the oppressed, and for those who will benefit from being released of their debt. Jesus has read these words and then he sits down. His reading then wasn't the end, but the sitting down indicates the beginning of his teaching on these words. Everyone is looking at Jesus and he says, today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Jesus is saying these words, it's me. Verse 18, the Spirit of the Lord is on me. That's me. Because he has anointed me. That's me, Jesus says. I am the one who has been anointed, and the Spirit of the Lord is on me to preach good news to the poor. The words of Isaiah, spoken many years ago, were pointing to Jesus. And Jesus says, and now I'm here. Verse 14 says, Jesus returned in the power of the Spirit. Jesus comes with power from God. And I, Jesus, says, I am the fulfiller. Scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. Jesus known. Scripture known? Excellent news for the poor, the prisoners, the blind, the oppressed, and those in debt. They think Jesus has come to put all this inequality right, to be the healer of physical ailments, to be the one to free those wrongly imprisoned and to pay off all the debt. What an amazing gift to the socially and economically poor. But is that it, though? Is that on its own all? Are the people blinded by the familiarity of the words? Jesus has come for more. Jesus, the Son of God, has been anointed for a ministry to be the fulfiller of all our needs. And while, of course, he was passionate about feeding the hungry, healing the sick, just as the early church was, We read about that in the Gospels and in Acts as well. But Jesus has come to be a holistic fulfiller for all of our needs for the whole of our lives. He came to bring hope and freedom to the spiritually poor, the spiritually blind, those who were prisoners in their sin, those whose sin oppressed them, those forever in debt because of their sin. What does it look like to be spiritually rich? To have your eyes opened spiritually, to know true freedom in Christ, to know truly what forgiveness means, and to know the good news of the gospel. Now, I noticed over the Christmas holidays just how much my windows needed cleaning. And there's a lot of windows in my house. And it's quite tall as well, so it's not an easy task. So I'm really fortunate enough to have a wonderful window cleaner. And looking outside, I thought that would solve the issue. It'd solve that issue of looking out and things looked a bit murky. And she came and she did a wonderful job. And yet from the inside, things still looked a bit murky. And I still need to clean the inside. And it's much easier for us to look out and see what needs doing and by whom should do it to fix the world's problems as they are, and there are many. But it's a lot harder for us to admit that there's work that needs doing on the inside, to see where we need to turn to Christ in our lives, where we may struggle with bitterness or anger or greed, where we need to repent, to say we are sorry, and to seek to walk in the light of his forgiveness. Have we too read these passages through only one set of lenses? Do we apply this passage in a way that holds only half the promises of Jesus, leaving the cup that Jesus offers half full? Or worse, and perhaps more relevant, is that glass half empty? So as we travel on this journey from familiar with the fulfiller, we're not alone. As we travel with Jesus, there will be moments of unfamiliar that stops us in our tracks, that reveals to us new things. It may be an uncomfortable journey as we travel towards fulfillment. But that final point for the people listening in the synagogue, who this message was for, was known. Verse 24, I tell you the truth, no prophet is accepted in his hometown. Jesus goes on to tell them of the Old Testament stories. He knew his scripture, and he's not shying away from his Jewish roots at all. Jesus speaks of Elijah, the widow, Elisha, and Naaman, part of the history of Israel, the people of God. And he speaks as serving as a reminder of and a warning from the period when the nation of Israel rejected God, a time where God was at work in the Gentile regions, providing for the poor widow who was trying to feed herself and her son, and where he healed Naaman, who had leprosy. Working in the Gentile regions as his own people had rejected him. The people of Israel had turned to idolatry and been unfaithful to God. They had rejected God's ways. To Jesus' words, their response in the synagogue was one of fury. He's hit a nerve. They thought they knew who this message, this good news was for. And they were right to a point. It was for them, but not exclusively for them, and not for those who choose to reject it. God's message was met with rejection in the Old Testament, and Jesus' ministry is met with rejection too. They have heard Jesus' teaching, and they've been in his presence, and now they have a choice. Reject him as the Israelites did and live as enemies of God, or accept him and see how God can work in their lives, how he can work in their hearts if they let him. Have they let familiarity, the name that they hold so dear, cause them blindness to the truth of accepting God as Lord of all? Those words in John 1 say, to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God. All who believe and receive. All who believe and receive. Jesus is making it clear that he has come for all. He has come as fulfiller for all people, that his promises do cover the physical, the emotional, the rejected part of our lives. But he has come too to restore the relationship between God and man, to open eyes, to open hearts, to open lives to the transformative power of knowing and living for Jesus. So as I conclude, the journey from familiarity to fulfillment is travelled with the fulfiller, with Jesus Christ our Lord. And it's a journey which may take us into the unfamiliar, seeking us to look at who Jesus is, to dig deeper into the words of Scripture, and to consider the promise of who Jesus came to save in a new light. We prayed at the beginning, may your word be a lamp to our feet. May your word, Lord, illuminate our walk with Jesus every day. And at times this might be uncomfortable as we see that what we held dear, perhaps those stories we heard as a child of that wonderful rainbow or the account of the feeding of the 5,000, while those words may have become so familiar to us, let the unfamiliar take us into new territory with Jesus. Just as those people in the synagogue did, let's find that deeper meaning to all that can be revealed from walking with Jesus Christ each and every day. We have a choice. Those people in the synagogue chose to push the good news away. The good news wasn't taken away from them. They chose to push it away. They wanted it to be only for themselves, and they were furious. They don't just turn their backs on Jesus, but they drive him out of town in order to throw him off a cliff. Jesus was driven to the cross for us. We have come to the end of our journey this morning, from the familiar to fulfillment, but not the end of our journey with Jesus in our lives. Let me leave you with this. We can choose to push the gospel truth away, to reject God's message, or we can choose to accept it, choose to receive the good news, where we will receive spiritual riches of sight, of freedom, of forgiveness, and of salvation through Jesus the fulfiller. Amen.
Thank you very much, Wendy. We come now again to a time of worship, so if you are able, please do stand as we sing our next song together, The Lion and the Lamb.
Oh,
Please do stay standing as we're going to come now to the time where we declare what it is that we believe as we share together the words of the creed. The words will be on the screen, and please do join in if you feel this is something that you can say out loud and declare. For those who aren't so sure if this is what you believe yet, do spend the time listening to the words and thinking them on your heart, because maybe, hopefully, one day in the future, it will be something that you can declare. We say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please do take a seat, and Isaac is going to bring us our prayers.
When I say, Lord, in your mercy, please respond, hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Dear Father God, we pray for our world. Every day there seems to be so much suffering in the news, but we thank you that you are always in control. We pray for the Nigerian elections as they go ahead despite ongoing violence, for those displaced from their homes by gang violence in Haiti, and for peace to finally overcome the war in Ukraine, and also for those suffering who are unknown to us, for they are still known to you. We pray for charities which bring aid to these people, and especially for charities which spread your gospel. We thank you for news from our mission partner, the Langham Partnership, for the completion of the Latin American Bible commentary. And we also pray for their preaching training in Turkey. We also thank you that the Ebola outbreak in Uganda has been officially declared to be over, and so echo these words from Psalm 145. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty. I will meditate on your wonderful works. They tell of the power of your awesome works, and I will proclaim your good deeds. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty Father, we pray that you would be with school children and university students, in particular with year 11s and 13s, who are at a busy period with mock exams in the build-up to GCSEs and A-levels. Please also be with those worried about university offers and applications as they make decisions about the next phase of their lives. Please help them to realise that whatever happens at school, university, or in exams, you are in control and have a plan for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Living God, we pray that you would work through our church in the local community. We thank you for the chance this year to hear more about our parish vision each Sunday. Please help our church to be built on the solid foundations of your word and of prayer. We pray for warm space and the upcoming Burns Night Cayley, which are, opportunities to show love practically. Please help us to be a welcoming church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We finish off by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you very much, Isaac. We come now to our final hymn. Again, please do stand if you are able as we sing together, I Cannot Tell.
Thank you.
you please do take a seat? We're coming now to the end of the service this morning, and let me remind you that if you wish to give as members of this congregation and want to make an offering, giving financially to the work of God in this church, the parish, and the wider world, you can do so. We have the plate and a card reader out in the foyer, which you'll pass on your way out. So let's give thanks to those offerings and those that have been made in other ways now. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour, and the majesty, and everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Amen. Please do, as always, stay for tea, coffee, refreshments. Spend some time talking to those you know, or even better, somebody who you don't know. It's a great time to catch up and share fellowship after our service this morning. Let's close now with a prayer of blessing before we leave. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way, the truth, and the life. Let us not stray from you, who are the way, nor distrust your promises, who are the truth, nor rest in anything but you, who are the life. For beyond you there is nothing to be desired, neither in heaven nor on earth. Amen. May God give to you and all those you love his comfort and his peace, his light and his joy in this world and the next. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among us and remain with us always. Amen.
House on the sandy line. Don't build it in the shore. Where it might have gone in nights, but you have to build it twice. For you have to build your house once more. You better build your house upon a rock. Make a good foundation on a solid spot. All the storms may come and go, but the peace of God you will know. Build your house on the sandy land. Don't build it too near the shore. Where it may look kind of nice, but you'll have to build it twice. For you'll have to build your house once more. You better build your house upon a rock. Take a good foundation on a solid spot. For the storm.